Shifu International.
Namaskar. Welcome to all around the world who are sincerely interested in Buddhism. I am Buddhika Sanjeeva from Sri Lanka. As a Buddhist and universal traveler, I have been to more than 25 countries in my 21 years of overseas traveling life. In my overseas traveling, I visited many Buddhist temples and most historically Buddhist places all around the world. Based on my experience in global traveling, I decided to share with you on the importance of these valuable places. This is the press program, Bodh Gaya, India. Today I bring to you an understanding based on Dhamma about 7 weeks Buddha spent after enlightenment at Bodh Gaya, situated in Bihar, India. Please join with me. Let's start our holy pilgrimage.
Bodh Gaya, the site of enlightenment of Gautama Buddha. Gaya is situated about 100 kilometers from Patna, the capital of Bihar. It is the one of the largest cities and is the most popular tourist destination in Bihar. This is the Bodhi tree that is situated on a huge platform. It is believed that this tree is the offspring of the actual tree under which Buddha attained enlightenment. Looking at the Mahabodhi tree, one might visualize the enlightened one being seated at the base of the tree for that whole week. From a very optical perspective, it is so. Yet the knowledge one derives from the Dhamma taught by Buddha tells us to see with wisdom. Buddha said, "This Dhamma of mine is only for the wise, and not for those without wisdom." What the Buddha did was to contemplate on his realization of the Dhamma that he achieved with the enlightenment. It is stated that after enlightenment, Buddha stayed the first week at the base of Bodhi. What is the base of Bodhi? Is it the base of the ficus tree? To understand, we need to delve deeper into the Dhamma. At the end of the first week, on the final night, Buddha in the first watch delved into the co-dependent origination. Then he saw that all things are dependently originated. When this is there, this arises. When this is born, this is born. In the middle watch, he noted that all things, when this is not there, this is not there. When this is ceased, this ceases. Then in the morning watch, he introspected into both the forward and backward directions simultaneously. This arises when this is there, and this ceases when this is not there. For that whole week, he looked deeper into what he realized, and it is said that the core aspect of his contemplation was the co-dependent arising or paticca-samuppada. Bodhi means realization. Enlightenment can come only if we walk the path of Dhamma shown by Buddha. The co-dependent arising is the base of realization. That's the first week at the base of Bodhi. Buddha spent the second week after enlightenment looking at the Bodhi tree without blinking his eyes. This is what great majority of people accept. Thus, they will venerate the location to the left on the front of the Mahabodhi temple at Bodh Gaya. This is the mundane way of realizing as to what happened during the second week after enlightenment. Buddha never advised to take things from the optical perspective, but to see from the super mundane Dhamma way. Let us now move on to the super mundane understanding. All conditioned things have arising, ceasing, and what is seen as there is change. Buddha said, because there are these three characteristics of all conditioned things. Arising can be seen, ceasing can be seen, and what is seen as is there, there is change from this to that, even at the blink of the eye. Thus it is termed the second week spent looking at Bodhi without blinking, meaning enlightenment, the unconditioned. Buddha realized that gods were uncertain as to whether he had attained enlightenment. To dispel their doubts, Buddha spent the third week walking in one direction, walking on a golden plank he had created with psychic powers in the air, while another Buddha created with the supreme psychic powers of enlightenment walked in the opposite direction, whereto that Buddha also walked on a golden plank that had been created by Buddha in the air. In our inglorious traversing of this samsara, we are never alone, but with a second person, that of craving. Even now, this second person craving is with us, pushing and pulling us in all directions. Buddha, to show this fact to the beings, be they gods or Brahmas or humans, did so in the third week after enlightenment. In the paeans of joy Buddha expressed soon after enlightenment, he said that craving is fully eradicated, thus no second person with Buddha. Buddha spent the fourth week in the golden abode. The normal parlance that is accepted by most people is that this abode was built by gods with gold for the Buddha to dwell during that week. But to understand the supermundane aspect of this, one needs to go deeper into the Dhamma. The Ratana Agara means the abode made of gold in a very somatic sense. The mundane people have agara or abode that can be pierced by lust, desire, etc. One may refer Dhamma Padastansas 13 and 14 in Yamaka Vagga. This abode or this world, the loka, is made of the six touch senses of eye, ear, nose, tongue, body and mind. Enlightenment had eradicated all the 10 fetters, and thus the Buddha is no longer dwelling in this form of six agencies abode, but is dwelling in the golden abode, which is not under the influence of any, and which he only made, and is not the making of the five aggregates. Buddha spent the fifth week under the banyan tree named Ajapala. One of the 16 disciples of Brahmin Bhavari, Ajita, asked Buddha as to what this adhesive is. Buddha replied that this great adhesive is japa or craving. The enlightened monk in the fifth week chose the base of the banyan tree Ajapa. Thus, Ajapa means that which does not stick, bind, attach, etc. Banyan tree, as it grows, starts spreading across the terrain with branches often parallel to the ground and supported by buttress roots, springing from the branches reaching the ground. After some years, there would be many such buttress roots that it is often becomes difficult to find the real base of the tree. It is the same with us, the mundane humans. After birth, we grow up and with craving and supported by the six touch agencies, grasp this world. We are thus termed lokika, worldly, who under the influence of the six touch agencies, whilst the enlightened are termed lokuttara, or no longer under the six touch agencies' influence, and thus beyond the world. Even though the enlightened one was seated under the banyan tree, just as the goat herders, yet he was not under the influence of the worldly phenomena. Buddha spent the sixth week after enlightenment in the middle of Muchalinda pond, and a cobra with a large hood came to protect Buddha from the rain, and also formed a wall around Buddha with its trunk and covered the head of the Buddha with its hood. But as stated earlier, with regard to each week, we have to see with the Dhamma the truth of what this is meant here. Here, since he was covered by the trunk and the hood of wisdom, no rain could get near him, as he is impervious to those due to Buddha having realized the knowledge of Asavakya Jnana, or the supreme knowledge of having destroyed the fermenting of desire, existence, false view and ignorance. Indeed, in the rainy season, when bhikkhus are in the temples, Buddha would tell them, "You are now protected from the external rain. do strive in this period to protect you from the internal defilings. Buddha spent the seventh week under the Rajayatana tree. We, the ordinary mundane humans and gods, spend all our lives under the Salayatana tree, or the somatic body of six touch agencies. Buddha said, in these six touch agencies yields the world arisen. With these six are acquaintances made. From having grasped with the six touch agencies, world afflicted. Buddha is Lokavidu, meaning he conquered this world and was thus supreme to this world of six touch agencies, and thus termed Rajayatana.
Buddha's teachings are most important for our whole life in every time. Buddha said, one who sees the Dhamma, see Buddha. See you again with another program soon. Sadhu Anmodana.